Ladies and gentlemen, in the interests of being efficient, we would like to get started. We understand that there is another session on things nuclear on Fukushima in 45 minutes, and we want to make sure that those of you who are also interested in attending that session have a chance to get there. My name is Bob Rosner. I'm from the University of Chicago, and I just want to say welcome to all of you. We are going to be talking about an issue that interests many of us, namely the back end of the fuel cycle in the international context. And my role here is, first of all, to welcome you and then also to introduce the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, which is the sponsor of this particular project. The American Academy is one of the oldest honorary societies in the United States. It's unusual in the sense that it not only holds the usual crowd of academics, but also folks from the business world, from the arts, from music. And so it's an interesting mixing place, meeting ground of people that are interested in topics of the day. The particular project that we'll be talking about is actually part of a larger project called the Global Nuclear Futures Project. And the Global Nuclear Futures Project had its origins about 4 or 5 years ago when some of us were quite concerned about the nuclear renaissance internationally. All of us, I think, recognized that such a renaissance was not really going on here in the United States. But certainly abroad, it seems to be flourishing. One only needs to look at places like, for example, China, which is building nuclear plants apace. Now, the reason, of course, for the interest on our part has to do with the fact that not only are countries that already are nuclear capable, like China, building nuclear plants, but there are also a very large number of nuclear aspirants, folks that are traditionally not part of the nuclear club, so to speak, that do have an interest in becoming attaining nuclear power. And many of them are not in the position, either from the human infrastructure or the technical infrastructure, to actually maintain a nuclear fuel cycle on their own. In some cases, of course, they have the financial resources to basically be able to purchase the expertise that they're missing. A good example of that would be the Emirates, for example. But many of the other aspirants are not in that position. And of course, the question then is, since it's widely recognized that a nuclear incident anywhere is consequential for all of us, how do we think about issues of nuclear safety, nuclear security? What happens to the back end? What happens to the used fuel, sometimes called the spent fuel, once it's been processed in places that don't necessarily have the resources to actually be able to deal with this material? Now, the project that you'll hear about addresses this issue directly head on, this lattermost issue. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to introduce shortly Stephen Goldberg, who's to my immediate left, who will be talking about the process that we underwent in order to produce the report that you all have now. And then James Malone, who will then be talking about the business case itself. And I think you have all the materials about our backgrounds in front of you. Our biography is actually in the back of those of the books that you have, so you can. I won't bore you with our CVs. So with no further ado, I'm going to ask Stephen Goldberg to take the microphone.